books are here. They have copies of the book that you're going to hear all about tonight, and our speaker will be over there after the presentation, signing them and greeting folks if you would like a copy of his book. And about him, tonight we have with us one of the absolute, probably the authority on Louis Armstrong in the world. He has written two Louis Armstrong biographies. He serves as director of research collections at the Louis Armstrong House Museum in New York. He has written liner notes for over a dozen Louis Armstrong releases, and is really excited. I was really excited to see this for him. For his the 2022 release, The Complete Louis Armstrong Columbia and RCA Victor Studio Sessions, he won a Grammy last year for his liner notes. So, yeah. So without further ado, let me bring up tonight's speaker, Mr. Ricky Riccardi.
Thank you, everybody. The first hour of tonight's presentation will just be me telling Grammy stories. So if anybody has any questions about what it's like to win a Grammy in the album notes category, I will answer them. I'm not sure if any Grammy winners have ever appeared on the stage. Well, no. The Baylor Project, they won. They were here 2 days ago. I'm happy to end the drought and bring the Grammys back to St. Louis. But I'm really here to talk about Louis Armstrong. And my portion of the program ties in with my book, Heart Full of Rhythm. And again, there are several thousand copies for sale in the corner. This book was the second of what is becoming a trilogy in reverse chronology. I wrote my first book, What a Wonderful World, in 2011, about the last 25 years. This book came out in 2020. It's about 1929 to 47, the middle of Armstrong's life. And I'm currently working on the third book, which will be Birth Until 1929. And then I'm getting out of the Louis Armstrong racket. That's enough. Three books and I'm out. But this book was very interesting for me, because the way Louis Armstrong's scholarship worked for so long is that Armstrong hits his peak in the 1920s with the band you see on that screen right there. That's the Hot Five. Some of you might have been here. I was here 4 years ago, did a whole presentation on the Hot Five. Nicholas Payton has said the Hot Five is more influential and more important than the Beatles and the Rolling Stones combined. This is the band that really writes all the rules of not just jazz, but American popular music. And because it's Mardi Gras Tuesday today, you know, kind of the epitome of that New Orleans sound. So just to put a little bit of the Hot Five in your ear, here's a little bit of Strutting with Some Barbecue from 1927. So that's the Hot Five. It's kind of the epitome of that trumpet, trombone, clarinet, banjo, piano sound. The Hot Five, though, that was not what Louis Armstrong was doing day to day. He was performing with big bands in Chicago, and the records, they were known at the time as race records. They were aimed strictly at African-American audiences, and they figured, well, this music will never really be popular. But that changed in 1928 when Armstrong recorded a song called West End Blues. How many people know West End Blues here? All right, very hip room. You'll know it by the end of the night, you'll know it. But for now, here is the cadenza that kind of set off the next 100 years of pop music and jazz. So Louis Armstrong does that 95 years ago this summer. And to a lot of folks in the jazz world, that was the peak. You know, from that moment on, Armstrong sells out. He goes commercial. You know, he's a clown, this and that. And so I set this book, Heart Full of Rhythm, pretty much immediately after West End Blues. It's like, all right, this is the supposed decline of Louis Armstrong. Let's begin there, because something very interesting happens in 1929. And that is OK Records. They see that West End Blues sells a lot of copies. And they had a producer named Tommy Rockwell. And was like, this Armstrong guy, He's doing something different, but he's never going to be a big success with banjo and clarinet and trombone. You know, what if we put him, instead of making race records, what if we put him on the pop series and we'll give him all the songs that all the white singers are doing? We'll give him a big band. We'll give him the same arrangements. You know, let's see what happens. And so in 1929, when the book opens, Armstrong comes to New York for 2 days in March of 1929. These are scrapbook clippings. Chicago's greatest, they called them. You know, they really put the word out. Armstrong had not stepped foot in New York in about 5 years, but he immediately plays the Savoy Ballroom, knocks him dead, and then he makes a recording, his first integrated recording with Jack Teagarden, the great trombonist. But then it was time. It was time for Louis Armstrong, the pop star. And for this, we kind of need to put it in context, because the song they chose was I Can't Give You Anything But Love, probably the big hit of 1928. And here is a perfect pop version of 1928. This is Johnny Kemp's orchestra, vocal by Hal White. This is how popular music sounded. We're not talking about jazz. This is how people sang. This is music 1928-29.
I can't give you anything but love, baby. That's the only thing I've plenty of, baby.
That's enough of that. So Louis Armstrong's going to record his version. And so what does he do? He slows it down. He changes the melody. He adds scat. He adds passion. Passion, a thing that was really not part of the American pop scene. And then he tops it with an incredible trumpet solo. So here is that iconic recording from March 5th, 1929. We'll pick it up from the vocal.
I can't give you anything but love, baby. That's the only thing I'm plenty of. Baby, dream my wild, scheme my wild, baby. You should do that. Find a love, a love, a love, a Aphrodite, and Niagara. All the things that you have probably do. Gee, I'd like to see you looking swell for baby.
Scatting.
Baby, love me below. Diamond bracelet. Woodward toss on sale. My little baby don't run on. Tell my lucky day. Your lucky day, you know, gone well. Baby, baby, I can't give you
now. That vocal goes off. People, I never heard anything like that before. You know, it's you hear the melody in the background, but he's not singing the melody. He's full of passion. He's throwing in extra babies in there. He's scatting. If you notice that last slide there, you know, they didn't want to take a chance yet, so they still released it as a race record, and they also released it as a pop record. The race record ad has a big photo of Louis Armstrong there. The pop ad, they did not include his photo. You know, we're talking 1929. But the record becomes a hit, and other singers are influenced by it. The great Ethel Waters, who was another fantastic singer from the 1920s, she records I Can't Give You Anything But Love in 1932, and she does basically an affectionate impersonation of Armstrong's vocal.
I can't give you anything but love, baby. That's the only thing I've plenty of, baby.
So that's Ethel Waters. It's, you know, it's not a parody, it's an impersonation. But 4 years after that, 1936, we get Billie Holiday's version of I Can't Give Anything But Love. And this, the way she phrases it, would not have been possible without Louis Armstrong's example.
Wild, dream wild, you
understanding that Billie always said Louis Armstrong was her number one influence. So this is, you know, the big takeaway here. There's been a million great instrumentalists, a million great vocalists. Louis Armstrong is the only person you could find who completely changes the way people play music on their instruments, and he completely changes the way people sing. And he does it all within a handful of years in the 1920s. The same day, he does it in a handful of hours. He finishes I Can't Give You Anything But Love on March 5th, 1929. And then, backed by Louise Russell's big band, who we see here, he does a song called Mahogany Hall Stomp. And he takes a three-chorus trumpet solo that would provide the inspiration for countless arrangements during the swing era. Here is that solo. So let's go back to just the beginning of that solo real fast. Just to show you how many people that influenced. I mean, here's the next generation of great trumpeters, the great Roy Eldridge. Here he is in the 1930s. The great white trumpeter, Bunny Berrigan. Here's a Little Gates special, again, in the late 1930s. I can do this all night, and I will. There'll be more, but I mean, I'm a third of the way through the presentation. I've done one day, and so this is, you know, the scope of Louis Armstrong's influence. So one guy just completely changing the rules. So they realize, all right, you know, this guy is now going to be a pop star. Let's send him to New York. There's a picture of Louis and his big band. He comes to New York and he gets a job doubling. There was a review called Connie's Hot Chocolates, and it was the music of Fats Waller and Andy Razzeff. And it was on Broadway, in the Hudson Theater on Broadway, and then they would go uptown and do the same show in Harlem at Connie's Inn. And Armstrong's big hit, he always said the number that really made him cross over was Fats Waller's Ain't Misbehavin'. And now, if you know about like the music business back then, once somebody had a hit with a song, there'd be 10 versions of the same song. Everybody would be recording the same song. That's why we have standards. So OK Records at the time, their biggest seller was the guy on the left there, a white singer named Sager Ellis. And so Louis Armstrong has a hit with Ain't Misbehavin'. Hey, Sager Ellis, why don't you come down and record Ain't Misbehavin'? So I made an edit. What we're going to hear is 8 bars of Sager Ellis and 8 bars of Louis Armstrong. Now we're going to go back and forth. And same studio, same record label, same song, same lyrics, same summer, same year, 1929. And here is my definitive illustration of Armstrong's impact on pop singing. Here's Ellis first, of course.
No one to talk with, all by myself. No one to walk with, but I'm happy on the shelf. Ain't misbehaving, I'm saving my love for you.
And now here's Louis.
No one to talk with, all by myself. No one to walk with. I'm happy on the show, babe. Ain't misbehaving. I'm saving my love. I'm saving love you. Really saving love you.
Back to Ellis.
I know for certain of one I love. I'm through with flirting. It's just you I'm thinking of. Ain't misbehaving. I'm saving my love for you.
And one more time, Louis.
I know for certain. One I love, through me flirting, you that I'm thinking of, ain't misbehaving, I'm saving my love, oh baby, my love for you.
Like Jack
Horner. All right, I'm stopping the fight here. But man, that Oh Baby, My Love for You, if that's not the birth of, you know, soul singing, R&B singing, Ray Charles, James Brown, everything that follows, that's it. And so if you notice, Armstrong starts infiltrating the world. It's probably hard for you guys to see, but that's the sheet music from After You've Gone, which he recorded in 1929. right-hand side, fourth man up, there's Louis Armstrong. He's the only African-American on the cover. And so this is kind of fascinating. This is one of my theses in the book, because usually the way American pop music goes is African-American creation is followed by white imitation. You know, you got in the 50s, got Little Richard doing Tutti Frutti and Pat Boone doing Tutti Frutti and the Rolling Stones doing Muddy Water songs and on and on and on and on. But here is Armstrong kind of infiltrating the lily white pop world from the inside, and he brings, you know, his gifts, he brings the blues, he brings swing, he brings all these things, and after he was done with it, you couldn't go back. Like I said, it was over. And so I can do the vocals all night. I was going to do one more. Should I do one more vocal or should I move on? I'm going to do one more. because you also have to put yourself in the era. I mean, if you know, like, you're Nat King Cole in the 40s, it was frowned upon. People didn't want him singing I Love You for sentimental reasons. You know, African-Americans singing I Love You. Hey, you know, white girls are going to hear this. They're going to get nervous. But here's Louis Armstrong in 1930. They give him a song, I'm Confessing That I Love You. And again, that sounds pretty passionate, not the way white people sang it.
I'm confessing that I love you. Tell me, do you love me too? I'm confessing that I need you, honest I do. Need you every moment. In your eyes I read such strange things, but your lips deny they're true. Will your answer really change things, making me blue? I'm afraid someday you'll leave me, saying can't we still be friends? If you go, you know you'll grieve me. All in life on you depends.
I'm playing the whole thing.
And I'm guessing that you love me, dreaming dreams of you in vain.
All right.
I'm confessing that I love you over again.
Okay. Thank you. That's enough of that. So Louis Armstrong records that in the summer of 1930, slows it down, and like I said, introduces passion into American pop music. And like I said, black sexuality on record on OK's pop records, 1930. Buck Clayton, the trumpet player, remember Armstrong used to sing this and people would faint. He said girls, women would be fainting. And, you know, we don't think, you know, we think maybe Elvis later on or whatever, but here's Louis again, the first pop star, 1930. Here's his vocal.
I'm confessing that I love you. Tell me, do you love me? I'm confessing that I need you. Honest I do. Oh, baby, need you every moment. In your eyes I read such strange things, baby. But your lips deny they're true, baby. Will your answer really change things, making them blue?
We'll hear more from Confessing later tonight, but that's just, again, the vocals I can do all night, but I don't want to forget the trumpet playing, because for all the critics and all the stuff about the Hot Five and West End Blues and all that stuff, people who were alive at the time said Armstrong in California, 1930 to 31, they had never heard him, so that was his greatest period by far. Unfortunately, he makes a lot of records in that period, and I want to play you one of his most influential solos. Here is I'm a Ding Dong Daddy from Dumas, and pay attention to the last break. And if you know what Louis Armstrong, he doesn't quote it, what he inspires a later composition. We'll keep it in the back of your mind. But here is this incredibly influential solo recorded the same month he did I'm Confessing, the same summer, 1930. Lionel Hampton on drums. Thank you. Sound familiar, anybody? I heard somebody say it. Salt Peanuts, Dizzy Gillespie. Young Dizzy Gillespie is listening to Louis Armstrong records. Here's that break. Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. And he comes up with... But even right before that, Louis was playing that line. Bum, 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 bum. Count Basie had an arrangement of Limehouse Blues. And what do you think the band plays for their shout chorus? So I think it was Benny Carter who said the swing era was nothing but orchestrated Louis Armstrong licks. And that's pretty much what it comes down to. All right, so... I could talk about the music all the time, but, you know, the book is actually kind of a page-turner because Armstrong gets himself, while he's in California, he gets arrested for the first time for smoking marijuana. He hires this man here, Johnny Collins, who kind of burns some of Armstrong's. He was an agent, and Armstrong had other bookings lined up, and Collins burned them. He said, you don't need to go to New York. We're going to go to Chicago instead. Armstrong is met in his dressing room by gangsters. They hold him at gunpoint. Here are original newspaper clippings from 1932. Gang mutes trumpeter, gang threats echo trumpeters, blares. So Armstrong's being held at gunpoint. He can't go to Chicago. He can't go to New York because the mob's waiting for him. He gets in the bus and heads down south. And this is really his first time doing a southern tour. He left New Orleans in 1922, goes back for the first time, 1931, immediately encounters racism on his first night there. And here he is telling you the story on the Dick Cavett Show in 1970.
You know, I'd been away about 9 or 10 years, and I done got northern fire. I done forgot about a whole lot of that foolishness down there, you know. But this night, they done propped this man up to just a big deal. Now you bring on Louis Armstrong, he's a New Orleans boy, and blah, blah, blah. So I'm straight, you know, all the boys said, this is nice. But a second before this cat had to go to that mic and bring me on, he walked away and said, I just can't introduce that nigga. Can't do it. Anyhow, they come to me and say, tell me what he says. I said, well, don't worry about it, you know? I said, give me a card, boys. And I walked to that mic, and he went, ta-da, shim, and I walked to that mic. And before I opened my mouth, there's all the white boys that I was raised with, you know, sitting up there, sharp, done got rich, maybe their fathers done left them the produce places and different things there. When we was kids, we'd hang around, and after school, we'd go out in the lots and play cowboys and Indians with old broken slates and things like that. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. We was the Indians. Oh, yeah. We fight them. And I've stood there 20 minutes, and they hollering, Dipper, Satch, blah, 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 blah. And when I went into Pavement Shining, man, you thought the walls was coming in. And this announcer standing there, you say, well, I didn't know this would happen in the South in New Orleans. It never happened before. So they fired him and everything, and I took over myself.
So that's a story with a happy ending, but Louis himself, he once said, you know, coming along, he said, I came from a time when a black man had hell. I mean, here's a picture. He humorously captioned it, tire inspection. But that's the band relieving themselves on the side of the bus because there was nowhere to go. And that song he sang a little bit there was his theme song for years when it's sleepy time down south. And after this particularly grueling tour of the south, where the band was arrested, I'll tell you more about that later. He went back in the studio and re-recorded When It's Sleepy Time Down South, but this time he changed the lyrics the last time through to When It's Slavery Time Down South.
Dear old Southland with his dreamers on. Take me back to the gallop zone. Oh, I love I am my own.
But, you know, he also changed a lot of minds. The book has a story of Charles Black. This is a picture from Texas in 1933 when Louis was passing through Austin. There was a dance he was performing. There was a young white teenager named Charles Black who went to the dance just because he thought he would meet a woman. And then Louis Armstrong comes on, and Black admitted that he was basically raised as a racist. And he goes, this is the first time he ever saw a genius And it was in a black man. It was Louis Armstrong. And it changed his whole life. And Charles Black ended up helping Thurgood Marshall write the Supreme Court case of Brown versus Board of Education. And he always said it began that night at that dance. And so, beautiful photo of Louis with integrated fans. So by 1932, 33, we're in the Great Depression, but Armstrong is the number one selling artist in the recording industry. Jazz, pop, anything, he is number one. Europe comes calling, and this is when we get this beautiful footage. I'm a little behind where I wanted to be, but I'd get fired if I don't show this footage, so I'm going to show it. It's Louis in Copenhagen, October 1933, doing Dinah. If you've never seen this before, it's going to change your life. If you have seen this before, it'll change your life. It's everything I've kind of talked about the first half hour, the singing, the scatting, the showmanship, the stage presence, the trumpet playing, all in one clip. Enjoy.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next number we're going to swing for you is one of the good old favorites. Yes, Dinah. Legate, boy. Are you ready? Dinah in the state of Carolina, if there is any, you know, show to me. Dinah, the Dixie eyes blazing, we love the city gazing to the eyes of Dinah Lee. Baby, every man, what I shake with fight for, cause my dynamite, change of mind, Bobby, did you see? Did you want to do China, man? I'll have a new line, oh, man. Oh, Dinah.
Dinah, there you go. How many people is it the first time you've ever seen it? Did it change your life? Just admit it. Admit it. If you don't admit it, I did this last time, people remembered it. If anybody's life has not changed, at the end of this presentation, I will fight you outside. So I did that 4 years ago. Nobody, no takers. I waited out there all night. You know, keep that in mind. Man, woman, child, I don't care. I'll be out there. He sounds great in that clip. I mean, that's perfect Louis Armstrong. But he was battling trouble with his lips. He was hitting so many high notes, he wasn't really letting it have time to heal. This is a photo from the 1960s there. You can see the damage he did. 2 months after that clip, he was playing in London, and he said a chunk of meat came out of the top of his lip, and blood ran down his shirt. He had to stop playing for 6 months. Meanwhile, the managers I told you about, the gangsters, they were all warring for his contract. He had no band. He had no recording contract. He was lived in Europe for a year and a half. He comes back. Here's a headline from the spring of 1935. Is he through? You know, he is at rock bottom. And coincidentally, this is when Benny Goodman comes up as the king of swing. The swing era begins. Everybody's finally, you know, grabbed on to Louis Armstrong's innovations, and Louis is stuck in Chicago, people suing him, people warring over his contract. He's got no lip. He had to go back, take a beginner's method. The man who got him out of this, and I don't have time for all the complexities, but the man on the left there is Joe Glazer. He was somebody from Chicago. He had connections to Al Capone. I'll kind of leave it right there. But let's just say he made all of Louis Armstrong's troubles go away. And by the end, all those gangsters sure disappeared after Joe Glazer came on the scene. Louis said, I quote him in the book, you know, if you got to deal with gangsters, you need a gangster yourself. And so that was Joe Glazer's job. And by the end of 1935, Louis was featured. This is a photo that ran in Vanity Fair magazine. He ended up taking over the orchestra of Louis Russell, which is Catherine Russell's father, and so there's a picture of Armstrong with the orchestra. He begins recording for Decca Records. He had one hit after another. Here's a little, Jeepers Creepers.
Get those peepers, all of those weepers, hot hypnotized, yes. When'd you get those?
I mean, this is the era of Jeepers Creepers, the era of when the saints go marching in and nobody knows the trouble I've seen, and I'm in the mood for love. And he's also doing Hawaiian music, and he's recording with the Mills Brothers and La Cucaracha. And it's just this wild period. Check out the Decca recordings. They're the greatest. But then this is also the period where he's knocking down one barrier after another. He becomes the first African-American to get featured billing in a Hollywood film when he appears with Bing Crosby and Pennies from Heaven. If you went to see that movie, there he is right in the credits. It's the first time an African-American ever appeared with the other quartet of white stars. And then in 1937, he became the first African-American to host a nationally sponsored radio show when he took over Rudy Valley's Fleischman's East show. And so here, get my plugs out of the way. The name of the book is Heart Full of Rhythm. The name of the song that Louis Armstrong wrote was Heart Full of Rhythm. Here's one of these historic radio broadcasts from 1937, set to a montage of photos and newspaper clippings from the African American press, which was crucial in my research for this book. Here is Heart Full of Rhythm.
The makers of Fleischman's Yeast bring you another fast and furious program featuring music by Louis Armstrong, the trumpet king of swing, and now the head gate himself, Louis Armstrong and his orchestra.
Yeah. I look here, got no shoes on my feet. I ain't got nothing to eat, but I've got a heart full of rhythm. Not a dime to my name, but I'm rich just the same. I've got a heart full of rhythm. When the times are gray and everything's wrong, I find my way by singing a song. Let the great think I'm small. Boy, I can laugh at them all. I've got a heart full of rhythm. Let it go. And now, folks, this is old Satchamount swinging at you. Playing one of them old good old good ones you know himself. A heart full of rhythm, yes.
And just to show you how his chops healed, I'm going to let it play through the trumpet solo. Technology, sir. So in 1941, Armstrong was actually asked, you know, what were the great achievements of your career? And he didn't talk about West End Blues or the Hot Five. He talked about the Fleischman's East show. He talked about Pennies for Heaven. Anytime he broke down a barrier, you know, that was a big part of his life. But by 1941, World War II hits, and here's a photo of Armstrong. He spent most of the war playing for the troops, playing military bases. And of course, a lot of great musicians ended up getting drafted. So he had to keep finding younger musicians, younger and younger musicians. And the saxophonist nearest to the camera there, with very large feet, that is none other than the great Dexter Gordon. who is centennial is next week, of course. And Dexter spent about 6 months in Armstrong's band, absolutely loved it. If he had won the Academy Award for Round Midnight, Maxine Gordon said he was going to dedicate it to Lewis. And we have a radio broadcast of the band doing Ain't Misbehaving, an arrangement you guys are going to hear in about 20 minutes. But you'll love this because Lewis says, "Brother Dexter," and brings on Dexter Gordon. What a great solo.
Like Jack Horner in a corner, don't go nowhere, and I don't care. All your kisses were waiting for me, me. I don't stay out late, don't care to go home about it. Me and my radio, misbehaving, stay my love. Brother Dexter.
Brother Dexter. Great Dexter Gordon. Well, Dexter, why did he leave the band? Because bebop's here, the new sounds of modern jazz. Dexter really wanted to be a part of that. And so, you know, of course, Dizzy Gillespie, 1944, 45, Charlie Parker, you get stuff like Dizzy's big band doing things like Things to Come. I mean, incredible music, the greatest, you know, but it's the end of jazz as America's popular music. And as I cover in the second half of my book, it brings on the jazz wars, where now everybody gets into camps. You got the swing era fans, the big band fans, you got the modern jazz fans. Then you get what they call the moldy figs, the people who only liked traditional jazz. And they get Bunk Johnson, who was one of the pioneers, and they basically dig him up and buy him some teeth and a trumpet. And Bunk, and they said, you know, this is the real thing. And Bunk's great, but, you know, it's this kind of stuff. That's someone Lewis heard when he was a kid. And so everybody's warring, and Lewis, he's kind of not paying attention. You know, he admires Dizzy, and at first he admires bebop, and he's happy. You saw him in the picture of Bunk Johnson, but he's doing well. 1945, he has a hit record with I Wonder. Here's the 30 seconds of it.
I wonder, my little darling, where can you be this moonlit night? Are you holding someone tight? Baby, I wonder.
A newspaper clipping there. His platter, I Wonder, had no longer hit the music stalls before the first pressing of 75,000 of the tune were gobbled up. Now Deck is pressing another 75,000 and expects Lewis's recording to hit the million mark. So he's doing just fine. But after World War II, the big bands, they're really done. And Lewis is still traveling. He's still on the road. There's a picture of him with the band bus looking pretty tired. And everybody's pulling at him in every direction. You know, there's the modern jazz side, there's the moldy fig side, you know, the swing side. What's he going to choose? R&B, Louis Jordan's on the scene, Sinatra's on the scene. And he ends up with this ingenious solution. He forms a small group, not just a small group. April 1947, Jackie Robinson integrates Major League Baseball. And in May 1947, Lewis did his first concert with an integrated band, Jack Teagarden, who he had first recorded with at the beginning of this presentation in March 1929. At the time, Mesmero said they used to talk about integration was their idea of the new millennium. And so now Lewis was going to lead an integrated band, and they were going to be a sextet. They were going to have a trumpet, trombone, clarinet. So it was going to kind of look like a New Orleans band, but the rhythm section was going to have Sid Catlin and Arvel Shaw, and they were going to swing, and Catlin was going to drop bombs like bop, and they were going to do Hot 5 numbers, and they were going to do R&B numbers, and they were going to do novelties and comedy songs and duets, and you couldn't put it in a category, which drove the critics crazy and drove everybody else crazy, but the All-Stars became the most lucrative, most popular, and my personal favorite period of Armstrong's entire career. And I'm going to close my portion of the program. That's the cue, band. I'm going to close my portion of the program with the last minute of Ain't Misbehavin' from this historic town hall concert. Really, here is elements of New Orleans swing, bop. It's all here. And it's like, this is it. He solved it. With the success of Town Hall, the sextet, Armstrong breaks up the big band 2 months later, officially forms the small group, and opens the door for the last 24 years of his life. Blueberry Hill, Mac the Knife, A Kiss to Build a Dream On, the Ella Fitzgerald albums, Lewis Place, W.C. Handy, Hello Dolly, What a Wonderful World, the biggest hit years of his life. And so that period, yes, I've covered that in the past, and everybody knows about the early years, but I do think this middle big band period was kind of lacking. A lot of writers, a lot of scholars just kind of thought nothing much happened, but to me, they probably were the most influential years of Armstrong's life. The music is impeccable. He broke down so many barriers for his race, and it's all told in the Jazz Times best book of 2020. Did anybody mention that? Yeah, well, it is. Heart Full of Rhythm. I'm done. I'm Ricky Riccardi, and that's the end of my portion of the program. Thank you. And so now, keep it going. Please welcome the Jazz St. Louis Big Band here with music director Adam Hookey on trumpet. Applause. I think Adam needs a microphone.
No, not really. Oh, hey. Hey, give it up once more for Ricky Riccardi. I mean these words very sincerely. I'm not sure there's anybody on earth that loves Louis Armstrong more than this man, and I don't think there's anybody that knows more about him that's living still. Is there anybody?
There might be.
But do they write books? They're not good sharers like you are?
Well, they're in their 90s.
That'll do it. We're going to play some Louis Armstrong selections for you, and Ricky will sometimes chime in with some stories in between, and I hope you have a lovely night. This music's a lot of fun to work on, and a little daunting also, but I hope the band thinks it's fun, and here we go. We're going to start off with Strutting with Some Barbecue.
Thank you.
some songs from us. It's not a big deal. They're just titles in my books and stuff. Don't worry about it. This one's not quite a title, but he said it's a very important part of his presentation and, of course, of Louis Armstrong's history. And so now we would like to do his arrangement of I Can't Give You Anything But Love. Happiness, and I guess all the things you grind for, baby. Gee, I think you are looking swell, baby. Diamond bracelets, what was doesn't sell your baby to that lucky day. I hope and pray, baby, I can't give you anything but love. Thankfully, I've got some wonderful friends up here who are also magnificent at the trumpet, and I wanted to pass some of these around a little bit. The first thing I asked all of them was, do you sing, or do you want to sing on stage? And let's just say we had three yeses. I really was happy to give the song to Dustin, because I asked him, how would you feel about singing Sleepy Time Down South? And he goes, I sing that. He's got a 9-month-old daughter at home, and he says he sings that to her sometimes when he puts her down to sleep. And I was like, I don't want to sing that. You're going to be way better than me. So.
Dustin Trump, everybody.
Thank you. shining on the fields below. The folks are crooning songs soft and low. You needn't tell me, boy, because I know, babe, when it's sleepy time down south. The soft wind blowing through the pinewood trees. The folks down there live a life of ease. When old mammy falls on her knees, oh babe, when it's sleepy time down south. Steamboats on the river are coming and going. They're splashing the night away. You hear those banjos ringing, all the people singing. They dance till the break of day. Dear old Southland with his dreamy song, take me back where I belong, right here in my mammy's arms, when it's sleepy time down south.
Mr. Dustin Shrum on the vocals. And I will say, I've heard you sing before, and I thought you were always a good singer, but that was better. And I don't know why you're not doing more of this. That sounded great. Right? It's okay to loosen up a little bit. We're the ones up here playing Armstrong transcriptions. You guys can relax. All right?
That they're playing are Louis Armstrong's charts. My day job, I'm in charge of the Louis Armstrong Archives in Queens. Has anybody been to the Louis Armstrong House Museum? Yeah, all right. So the Louis Armstrong House Museum is located in Corona, Queens, the house where Louis Armstrong lived the last 30 years of his life. And we have the world's largest archives of any single jazz musician. And that includes the big band books. My presentation ended, the book ends with Louis breaking up the big band. In real life, he took 270 parts. All the original cases, put them in his basement, and they stayed there from 1947 until he died in 71. His wife died in 83. Queens College took over. The archives opened in 94. And then finally, in 2016, we received a $2.7 million grant from Robert F. Smith to digitize the entire archives, including the charts. So everything you're hearing tonight are on these... these yellowed PDFs, but these are the original charts that Armstrong and his big band played. I have never heard most of these in live settings, so I am thrilled, but I just thought a little context might help because they're really doing an incredible job with some very hard. That's all I got.
Thank you.
Continue with the song that makes girls faint. This is the popular women fainter from 1930. Confessin', way before the Beatles and Elvis. All right. By the way, it's been about 24 years since my last confession. And I hope I don't feel as guilty and shameful after all those other ones as I do on this one.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right. We're going to pass the microphone now to Miss Dawn Weber. We've asked her a few times to play with this group, but she's always got, I've got Bach Society tonight. Or something like that. Something that pays much more than this band, Adam. She said that every time. Is that a good introduction? I've been literally watching this musician play since high school, and she's been a great inspiration and a great trumpet player around town. She hustles hard, and we're glad to have you, Dawn.
On Bill Run up the lazy river with the noonday sun, linger in the shade under a kind old tree. Throw away your troubles, dream a dream of me, dream a dream of me. Up the lazy river with the robin song, bright lights go as we stroll along. Blue skies up above with the one I love. Up the blessed river, how happy we will be. Oh, Papa, won't you come on back? So don't let me so don't so that so let don't so that so don't see but on that way down so no. So the devil on the sun that we down. So the night there. So the don't the
So in addition to the fact that these are actual Louis Armstrong arrangements, this makes sense if you think about it. Louis didn't need music because he had all these things memorized and they were kind of built the charts around him. So whoever's doing Louis on whatever song, we don't have a part. And but thankfully, you know, Ricky has lots of all these archives. He's like, this was recorded. This was never recorded on an album, but it's on this one radio broadcast from 1942. Here you go. I mean, and I'm not exaggerating. And some of those are great. Those announcers and stuff. Some of them are horrible. There's one guy. His name is Louis Armstrong, not Louis Armstrong. And there's one guy that he goes, here he is, Louis Armstrong with Ain't Misbelievin'. He got the name of the song title wrong and everything. But my favorite one is that Sunny Side of the Street guy. Will you do that for us? Do you know it?
Any fans of the late Ernie Bubbles Whitman? He was
the he's the direct predecessor to Wolfman Jack.
All right, Ernie Bubbles Whitman. This was Jubilee. It was a famous show, one for the troops, African American troops during World War II. I'm not going to do his voice, but I'll do his words. Okay. It's Ernie Bubbles Whitman. Thank you. Men, here we go with another portion of Jubilee, served piping hot from the cat's own casserole. Got some dynamic dishing out to do from a mess cook full of melody. We got heat, we got sweet, we got every gator's meat. So let's park the patter and chatter. Louis Armstrong, you've got the batter, so serve up a platter. Sunny side of the street, Mr. A.
Street. I used to walk in the shade with those blues on parade, but I'm not afraid. This rover crossed over. If I only had 1 cent, I'd be rich as Rockefeller. Gold dust at my feet, on the sunny side of the street, grabbing up your coat, hat, boots, everything. Leave your worries on the doorstep, cause we're going bye-bye. Just direct your feet, you will meet on the sunny side of the street. Can't you hear the pitter and the patter of the raindrops trickling down your fire escape and ladder? Life can be so fine, fine as wine. I used to walk in the shade with those blue young beret, baby, I'm not afraid. If I never had a cent, I'd be rich as Rockefeller. Gold dust at my feet, on the sunny side of the street. Thank you.
Wikipedia, much faster than Wikipedia. So Ain't Misbehaving, this is the song that I mentioned three times during the presentation. So obviously a big one. Louis Armstrong said this was the one responsible from crossing over in 29. Then we heard the Dexter Gordon version from 44, and then the final version from Town Hall, a song that followed Armstrong decade after decade. But this is the arrangement that the Dexter Gordon version as a World War II broadcast. Teddy McRae was the director of the band. As Adam mentioned, Louis Armstrong, great trumpet player, great vocalist, did not really care to be a band leader. You know, all the headaches of leading a band and writing arrangements and writing songs and all that stuff. Nope, he was going to do what he did, and that's why he always had a very strong band leader. First it was Louis Russell, then Joe Garland, and then this comes from the Teddy McRae. So does Groovin', so I might as well do two introductions in one. Groovin' is a rare number, the only number of Dexter Gordon recorded with the band in the studio from the only session. But I walked in last night off the airplane, flew from LaGuardia, came in, I was exhausted, and they were rehearsing this chart, and I've never felt better in my life. So let's see if I can do it again. Ain't Misbehaving, or Ain't Misbelieving.
who is that Ellis, the white guy that did it poorly?
Oh, yeah. Is anybody going to be playing the role of Sager Ellis tonight?
Sager Ellis. Yeah. We're going to do that version.
Oh, good. You're going to do that
version. We're bringing him back.
I'm going to go on.
There's many documentaries on rock and roll, but there's when Little Richard comes out with Tutti Frutti, then they put out Pat Boone's version.
Right.
And
right.
It's the same kind of...
Yeah.
I wish somebody would do that 8 bars by 8 bars. That would be great.
Next time.
No one to talk with. By myself, no one to walk with, I might be on the ship. Ain't misbehaving, saving my love for you. Know for certain, what I love, through with flooding is you that I'm thinking of. Ain't misbehaving, saving my love for you. Like Jack Horner, in a corner. Don't go nowhere, and I don't care. Oh, your kisses are worth waiting for, believe me. I don't stay out late, don't care to go home about 8, just me and my radio. You're misbehaving, saving my love, Brother Joe.
just have a few more tunes for you. We're going to feature Mr. Dustin Shrum again on an instrumental song called Grooving. So we're going to feature Mr. Daniel Campbell on this next one. We had a bunch of songs to choose from, and eventually some of them get cut. And again, we didn't really have charts for these Lewis parts, so it was a little, what are we going to do for some of these? And I asked Danny if he would like to sing, but he's got laryngitis tonight. And so if it's okay with you, he's going to play the solo on this song. But I'm just helping him out. And the reason he has laryngitis, he's been working on his Louis Armstrong impersonation so much. Tell him something, Danny.
Oh, yeah, I'll start it up.
I said Louis Armstrong, not Miles Davis. That's fine. All right, this is a a Louis Armstrong song called You Didn't Learn That in School. You don't learn that in school. Venus was a woman who had lots of charms. She got so much loving that she wore out both her arms. You don't learn that in school. Yes, you don't learn that in school. There ain't no doubt about it, you don't learn that in school. King Arthur was a hero, he was famous everywhere. He had a big round table cause he couldn't stand a square. But you don't learn that in school. No, you don't learn that in school. There ain't no doubt about it, you don't learn. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Daniel Campbell. One thing you should know, he only robbed the rich folks cause the poor folks had no dough. But you don't learn that in school. Yes, you don't learn that in school. There ain't no doubt about it, you don't learn that in school. Strong as the king, pops his tops, what they say. The reason he's so smiley, cause he today. But you don't learn that in school. Yes, you don't learn that in school. There ain't no doubt about it, you don't learn that in school. Yes, you don't dig that in school. We got one more for you, and I believe we have a story before this one, but thank you so much for being here tonight. Give it up one more time for Mr. Ricky Riccardi.
Dan, holy smokes.
Real quick, in the saxophone section, Mr. Joel Vanderhayden, Harvey Lockhart, Jason Swagler, Ben Reese, Andy Amen, our trombonist, Mr. Jim Owens, Cody Henry, John Siddle, Gabe Miller. On piano, we have Mr. Antonio Foster. Yeah. Travis Madison at the guitar. Eric Warren on bass. Mr. Kevin Giannino on the drums. In your trumpet section, Miss Don Weber. Daniel Campbell. Dustin Shrum. My name is Adam Hookey. Thank you so much. We'll see y'all next time.
Four trumpet players that play the role of Louis Armstrong. Did anybody lose a chunk of meat from their top lip? Anybody? All meat is intact? Okay, good. This song does involve a quick anecdote. It's in the book. And again, remember, afterwards, I'll be in the corner there. I've got three kids. They haven't eaten in years. I have, though. nice. That's good. we didn't rehearse this. No, but this is a serious story with a funny punchline. I told you earlier about that grueling tour of the South in 1931, 32. Armstrong came back singing when it's slavery time down South. At one point, the band was traveling through Memphis. They had a brand new bus. It was a deluxe bus. And now we're talking about 12, 13 African-American men. Lewis's manager, Johnny Collins, was a white man. He couldn't make the tour, so he sent his wife to go with the band. And so in comes this brand new bus, 12 or 13 African-American men, one white woman. The police sees them, arrest the whole band, arrested them immediately. They insisted they take a dilapidated bus. The musicians would not get off the bus, so the police drove the bus to jail. Armstrong realized once he got into his cell that he had an inordinate amount of marijuana on him. And so he turned to his friend and goes, well, what should we do? He goes, well, let's demolish the evidence. And so they did. But the police were awful to them. I mean, calling the N-word, and you don't come to Memphis and think you run the South. You know, we need some cotton pickers. It's really hellish. And so Lewis and the band were stuck in jail. One member of the band actually escaped and called Johnny Collins, the manager. The manager called the chief of police, and they let Louis Armstrong's band out. Okay, the next morning, Armstrong has to play in Memphis. Who's there? The chief of police. And so Lewis goes up to the microphone and says, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to dedicate this next number to the chief of police. And this is the song he played.
I'll be glad when you're dead, you rascal, you.
I'd like to dedicate this to one of my best friends, Mr. Cody Henry. Because you gotta have this, you have to sing this to somebody. You can't just sing it to nobody. I love you, Cody. Hope you die soon. That's what this song's about. I can't wait to do your eulogy. All the time. You talking to my wife when I'm not around? You eating all our food? My dogs like you better than me. I don't like this, Cody. I hope you die soon. Oh, I'll be glad when you're dead, you rascal, you. Say, I'll be glad when you're dead, you rascal, you. I took you into my home. You won't leave my wife alone. I'll be glad when you're dead, you rascal, you. Oh, I'll be glad when you're dead, you rascal, you. I'll be tickled to death when you leave this earth, you dog. I thought you was my friend when you drank up all my gin. I'll be glad when you're dead, you rascal, you. For some cabbage, then you smoked it all just like a savage, man. I don't even know why you're here right now. Let me show you something. You better play for your dinner tonight, Cody. Go ahead.
hand for Cody Henry. That rascal he is. Thank you so much. We'll see y'all next time. We are the Jazz St. Louis Big Band.